No, no way. It's history that teaches us that, the one with a capital H. If Earthlings managed to create self-sufficient communities on Mars, the initial colonists will consider themselves Earthlings and abide by Earth's laws, at least in the beginning. However, as the generations pass, this won't satisfy them anymore. They won't feel American or Russian or from wherever they came. They'll feel Martian. They'll say, listen, we don't want to pay taxes anymore and we want to develop our legal system. And then the troubles will begin. It seems inevitable. In 20 years or two centuries, humans will undoubtedly set foot on the moon and Mars, establishing the first colonies. How do you think things will unfold? After a certain number of years, will the colonies demand independence? And what will Earth do in that case? Cut off supplies? Sever communication? Is there a risk of an actual conflict? In the case of open rebellion, is it ethical to destroy a colony to win? Well, knowing human nature and the tendency of history to repeat itself in different contexts and environments, I'd say our great-great-great-grandchildren will have this challenging dilemma to face. It's better to start thinking about it now, don't you think? So we've prepared a video for you where the first part presents the theory behind this perverse mechanism called independent syndrome. And the second part chronicles how things could unfold in the event of a rebellion by some lunar colonies. Enjoy! Even in less stressful situations than an ongoing war, humans have always looked suspiciously at those individuals who, at some point in their lives, decide to join a group or a nation different from their own. For example, 19th century American colonists who chose to live among Native Americans, or Westerners during the Cold War who spent time in the Soviet Union. Even if they returned, they were no longer considered trustworthy, and perhaps they were no longer one of us. This attitude is likely to be much more pronounced and acute in the relationships between space settlements and Earth, or between different space settlements, where distance severely limits contact between distant populations. A fitting example is the colonization of North America and Australia, where both groups of colonists relatively quickly came to consider themselves different from those living in their homelands. This happened even though their cultures did not differ significantly from the original. Both groups, for example, retained the English language, Christianity, and much of Anglo-Saxon culture. The same happened in all previous historical colonies where the separation from the motherland and adaptation to local circumstances, including contact and intermarriage with indigenous populations, initiated the process of cultural and identity differentiation. Similarly, it is likely that initially space colonists will continue to identify and express loyalty to their Earth origin nations. In practice, nationalism in space will essentially be transferred from Earth nationalism to other places, i.e. colonists will identify as Americans on Mars or Russians on the Moon, just as the pioneer colonists in the Americas considered themselves English in New England or Spanish in Mexico. However, over time, and it took less than 150 years in the case of the British colonies in America, some or all descendants of those early colonists will begin to think of themselves as Martians or Lunarians. The ultimate point of this physical and cultural differentiation will be a population of humans born in space who consider themselves no longer Earthlings. Many of them, similar to second-generation Anglo-Saxons who colonized North America, may never have visited Earth and therefore may feel no connection to it. Three consequences are thus predictable with a reasonable degree of confidence. Firstly, lunar and Martian colonies will soon, within the time frame of the second or third generation, begin to claim their independence from Earth. Any country or company thinking of establishing permanently subjugated settlements in space is ignoring centuries of terrestrial colonial history. Colonies will begin to feel rightly or wrongly exploited and oppressed by burdensome taxes and foreign laws, or treated without respect as mere resource producers without rights or identity. Any pretext will be good, and rebellion may also arise for ignoble purposes from the ambitions of individuals or parties within the colonies. Once the revolutionary process begins, unless human technology has invented much faster space travel with much larger ships, it will be very difficult for Earth to transport an armed force quickly enough to quell the uprising. Therefore, political independence would be a relatively achievable goal for the colonists. Think about Mars, hundreds of millions of kilometers away, but even the Moon, much closer, possesses insurmountable logistical problems. This raises the second expectation. Excluding a profound change in human nature, it is almost inconceivable that rivalries, hostilities, and violence will not flare up sooner or later between the colonies and Earth, and even among the colonies themselves. Larger or more aggressive colonies could unleash wars against their neighbors, competing for territory and resources, redrawing borders, and annexing other settlements. In the third place, experience teaches us that we might expect the rise of new types of space imperialism. Some former colonies might choose to form alliances and treaties with other colonies or with particular Earth nations. In short, there are truly many scenarios, especially when dealing with a strategic chessboard as vast as the solar system. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. To make easy predictions, things could go almost exactly like this. It's the year 2133 when the first stable base on the Moon is built, called Freedom. Unbeknownst to them, the astronauts working there have also laid the first cornerstone of the future Selene City. The base is energy independent, utilizing solar panels during sunny periods that last for weeks, and storing atmospheric hydrogen for dark periods. For over 10 years, it houses a maximum of about 10 people. Meanwhile, China sends its probes and satellites to avoid future colonization exclusively led by the USA. Fox portrays it as an act of war, but the UN denies it, stating if the United States sends its probes, the People's Republic of China has the right to do so, says the honorary president. The first Chinese expeditions land in 2139, along with the arrival of the first Indian satellites and a Russian space station. In 2141, the first base undergoes substantial modifications. Now it can stably accommodate up to 40 people without space or energy issues. Additional American bases are established throughout the satellite, along with Chinese ones and the first ones from India and Russia. European, Japanese, and Brazilian satellites enter lunar orbit, while second and third world countries organize themselves to join the lunar race. From 2141 to 2145, the sizes of all American bases increase, and in 2149, the construction of the first bases of the wealthiest Earth multinational corporations begins, led by Microsoft, General Motors, Telecom, and SpaceX. By now, all superpowers are rapidly building bases and expanding existing ones. Also, in 2145, the first helium-3 refining center is built, preparing and converting the rare element into energy to be sent to Earth. 5 years later, American refineries surpass a dozen, while other nations also enter this lucrative trade with Earth. Starting from 2150, space travel trusts emerge on Earth, offering for those willing to pay hefty sums a journey to the Moon. It's essentially a clandestine immigration traffic for those unwilling to undergo the lengthy medical and bureaucratic checks imposed by terrestrial authorities. Thus, the first tourist or pseudo-tourist expeditions take off, around which a business is created that serves as an economic driver for mass colonization. Venturing to the Moon and becoming permanent residents with discounted prices, more or less legal journeys, and companies offering ever-expanding discounts has become feasible, but it remains a significant expense. Typically, future colonists sell all their Earth properties, while those with nothing to sell can only wait and watch the rockets streak across the sky every day. Every day, thousands of people set off for the Moon, rich in promises, seeking employment, freedom from the state, and the thrill of living on another planet. By 2160, the lunar population, including colonists, technicians, and astronauts, reaches 1 million semi-permanent inhabitants. Meanwhile, the number of refineries has increased to the point where the energy crisis on Earth begins to weaken. Helium-3 is nationalized, and restrictions and pressures on colonies to increase production intensify. Children are born in lunar bases, hospitals and shopping centers are established, and soon the larger bases become small cities where life becomes less Spartan. However, this holds true only for the older bases. Elsewhere, especially those near the North Pole, life still exists in conditions of pure survival. In 2162, Earth abandons the principle of space nationalization, and while remaining divided into nations, establishes that all space activities will henceforth be conducted by a common organization called Mother, including the management of colonies. In 2179, colonies begin exporting resources such as rare metals, solar energy, water, and biotechnological products to Earth. These exports generate huge profits that colonists invest in new infrastructure and technologies. Space colonies thus become emerging economic powers, challenging Earth's dominance. By 2202, the lunar population reaches 10 million, with a workforce and industrial development capable of ensuring a fairly dignified standard of living, although still distant from that on Earth. Selene City, the largest base city, now hosts over 200,000 colonists. Most bases have progressed sufficiently to resemble real cities with their own economic life. Additionally, all colonies begin digging underground tunnels to expand and connect with each other. Starting in 2220, thanks to the accumulated enormous profits, interplanetary travel companies can finance expeditions throughout the solar system. Interest in Mars is rekindled, previously considered too far to serve Earth's interests. Many believe that technological advances may now make terraforming a viable option. The lunar colonies feel bypassed by these changes. In 2222, spokespersons from various bases meet to agree on a set of demands to present to Mother, including the liberalization of helium-3 production and all other mining extractions. These are the first coughs of a legal epidemic. Mother receives the document but takes time and does not respond. In 2223, LUNA, Lunar United Nations Assembly, is established, representing the rights of 13 out of the 21 colonies on the Moon. Intercolonial enterprises quickly form, rallying against terrestrial presence in the lunar economy. LUNA fans the flames, and public opinion in the colonies begins to express impatience and hostility towards anything non-lunar for at least two generations. Tourism is boycotted, and dozens of helium-3 refineries are vandalized. Although these anti-terrestrial biases do not lead to outright hatred towards Earth, as the purest lunatic is only of the fifth generation, and a true lunar culture is still in its infancy, they generate a sense of resentment towards its political and economic dominance. In 2229, riots erupt in major lunar cities. LUNA is controlled by two factions, the Reds and the Blues, politically opposed between revolt and moderation. Moreover, the dispute is complicated by colonies that have not yet joined the Lunar United Nations Assembly, and by the activities of terrestrial secret agents. In many colonies, movements advocating greater economic and political independence emerge. While initially minority movements, they gain increasing success with the stiffening of terrestrial sanctions. The first clashes between various colonial militias for resource control are recorded. All this confusion obviously benefits Earth, and hatred towards the cynicism of its politicians continues to grow. In 2230, the first union, the Lunar Trade Union, is also established, initiating numerous strikes whenever needed. Mother declares it illegal, but it has already reached 5 million members throughout the Moon. In the early months of 2231, almost half of the lunar population desires independence and is ready to fight for it. Despite the terrestrial orbital blockade, the first heavy weapons begin to be secretly brought to the Moon. In Moon City, a stronghold of the Red Faction, emissaries from all independence parties secretly convene. The Lunar National Party is founded and the first Congress is inaugurated, declaring the Lunar Parliament's establishment. The Lunar Parliament announces a referendum for independence held in November. On December 12th, it is declared, "In virtue of the decision made by the people of the Moon and by the power granted to us by the said people, whom we are called to represent in this assembly, this Parliament proclaims the Moon's independence from Earth." On Christmas Day, the Declaration of Independence is brought to Mother's lunar headquarters for co-signing. But terrestrial authorities refused to receive the delegation and, in response, mobilized troops. The Lunar Secession War begins. The Earth forces, despite being technologically more advanced, faced challenges in the Lunar Secession War. Initially, they attempt to invade the larger colonies to weaken the lunar resistance by targeting the most populous centers. However, the colonists playing on their home turf effectively resist, employing guerrilla tactics and taking refuge in underground tunnels and secondary colonies. The colonists make it difficult for the invaders to strike directly. Moreover, the invaders lack sustained support, while the colonists deplete resources that they leave behind. In a short time, the conflict transforms into a war of attrition, with the invading forces dwindling in number. As is often the case when a preponderant military force is constrained by public opinion back home and a weaker but more motivated army gains the upper hand, the latter prevails. The Earth forces, less convinced and hindered by the Moon's weak gravity, to which they are unaccustomed, suffered a series of defeats in direct confrontations. Meanwhile, the colonists suspend deliveries of helium-3, triggering an enormous energy crisis on Earth and sparking a strong protest movement that likens the Moon to a reload of the United States War of Independence. The coup de grace occurs when lunar colonists use their largest gravitational elevator to launch massive rocks at Earth, causing floods and small tsunamis in the Pacific Ocean. It serves as a warning and a demonstration that it is much easier for the Moon to strike Earth than for Earth, located in the gravitational well of the Earth-Moon system, to hit its own satellite. Upon realizing that the game is not worth the candle, Mother offers surrender, or the responsibility requested, pacification, as the Earthlings call it. 2 days later, on March 24, 2232, suggested first by China, then by the European countries, and then by all others to the UN. In the Saline City Conference on April 2, 2232, Earth acknowledges the Lunar Parliament, granting the colonists binding rights, while maintaining a minimal share of actions and rights on the two pro-Earth colonies. Additionally, it is stipulated that the Moon has the right to decide on all its matters, including the economy and immigration, imposing the first restrictions on Earth immigration. The treaty also entails the creation of an international organization called the Space Council, tasked with promoting cooperation and security in space. The Space Council has the power to intervene in case of human rights violations, military aggression, or environmental threats in space. Furthermore, the Space Council is responsible for regulating the exploration and exploitation of space resources, ensuring adherence to the principles of equity and sustainability. In 2233, Earth and the Space Federation initiate a cultural exchange program, allowing citizens from both worlds to visit and study in each other's realms. The program aims to foster understanding and dialogue among diverse cultures and identities, mitigating mutual prejudices and suspicions. Additionally, the program has the effect of stimulating scientific and technological development through the sharing of knowledge and experiences. In 2241, Earth and the Space Federation launch a joint mission to the outer solar system to explore the gas giant planets and their moons. This mission stands out as the most ambitious and expensive ever undertaken, involving thousands of scientists, engineers, astronauts, and journalists. Beyond its scientific objectives, the mission holds significant symbolic value, representing the first shared space venture between Earth and the Space Federation. The mission succeeds, leading to the discovery of new phenomena and potential forms of life in space. For the Martian colonies, future history may unfold quite differently. If you agree, we'll delve into that topic in an upcoming video. All right?